Welcome to Jane Jackson Careers, a podcast that takes your career to the next level. Here's your host, Jane Jackson, author of Amazon Careers bestseller, Navigating Career Crossroads.
Welcome back to my careers podcast, where I interview fascinating professionals who've made amazing career changes. Now, today, I am so honored to have Professor Sattar Bawany, all the way from Singapore, who is the Chief Executive Officer of the Center for Executive Education, which is CEE Global. He's also the Managing Director, as well as Master Executive Coach and Facilitator with Executive Development Associates, Asia Pacific. Now, Sattar is the Adjunct Professor and member of the International Advisory Board of Curtin Graduate School of Business in Western Australia. He has over 30 years international business management experience, including 20 years in executive coaching and leadership development with global management consulting firms, including the Hay Group, Mercer, and DBM. Now, Sattar's work includes the professional development of women and ethnically diverse professionals and supports their growth as potential future leaders of their organizations. He is a fellow of the International Professional Managers Association, IPMA, and the Chartered Institute of Marketing. He's also a professional member of the Society of Human Resource Management and the Chartered Institute of Personnel and Development. He's a practicing member of the International Coach Federation and International Association of Coaching. So with that wonderful background, I am really happy to welcome Professor Sattar Bawany to the show. Hi, Sattar. How are you?
Hi, Jane. Thank you very much. I'm fine. Thank you. Thanks for having me here.
Yeah. Oh, well, it's so nice that you've agreed to come on. And I know it's around about 5 o'clock in the afternoon in Singapore, and it's about 8 o'clock in the evening in Sydney. So thank you for your time. And I'd love to find out all about you and all the career changes and your career path. So how about, just to kick us off, could you tell us a little bit about your career aspirations in your early days, when you're a little boy or when you're a teenager or just in the early days, okay?
Well, in the 80s, my professional career started in the 80s when I was a medical sales rep, you know, selling pharmaceutical products to doctors and hospitals in Singapore. Mm. And subsequently in Malaysia. And over the years, through my own hard work and effort, I've managed to be promoted to be the sales supervisor, sales leader, sales manager. And my last role, professional role in healthcare, was that of a marketing manager. Mm-hmm. So my interest in sales and marketing, has been for about 15 years, and that led me to pursue a certificate in sales marketing, a diploma in marketing for the Chartered Institute of Marketing in the UK, and I was subsequently accorded the fellow of the Chartered Institute of Marketing in the early 90s.
Oh, wow. So you had a sales and marketing background in the early days, and so very, very different from what you're doing now. So how about, tell us, how did you get to where you are today?
Yeah, today, my role has been, as you know, that I've been, through introduction, I've been involved in executive coaching, leadership development. But it all started in my last role with a medical device company called Carl Zeiss Germany. It's a German company which developed medical instrumentation. And in that role, one of my responsibilities is looking at developing the sales team, sales and marketing team as a trainer, in-house trainer, and helping them to be able to equip the right skills to be able to, help the company to grow. And through that responsibility, that role, my passion in training and development started, and I've attended programs looking at various books that by authors like Zig Ziglar, Brian Tracy, Tom Hawkins, to just name a few. Mm-hmm. And that really allowed me to develop a strong sense of purpose in trying to help people to be better, help the, of course, at that point in time, the salespeople that I lead the sales team within the organization, not only Singapore, across the region, but it's more about how to empower people, how to empower your team to help them to be more effective in what they do. And I used, at that time, I used the acronym called SGM to shape, to guide, and to mold them to be able to be effective what they do, as whether sales professional or sales manager, through asking more questions, getting them to discover within themselves the issue, the challenge that they face, instead of telling them the solution. Mm-hmm. And that actually, that leads me to my early days into the, or early foray into the world of coaching, so to speak. Mm-hmm. So that's where coaching started. And of course, you know, over the years through other organizations that I work with, Mercury, Hay Group, Mercer, and DBM, through this organization, I've been given the opportunity to learn, to develop my executive coaching practice, my coaching skills, and how do I use that to help my client to be more effective as a leader and help them to be able to solve the day-to-day managerial leadership challenges. That has been for the last 2 years, and that's been very satisfying, and I enjoyed that very much.
I think with that sales background, and especially transitioning into training as well, where I like your SGM, the shape, guide, and mold. So that's a wonderful leadership term, really, isn't it? I expect that, you know, with all of that training and helping people to grow themselves, and then working with more and more of the senior management, that must have really developed your interest in executive coaching and how to continue to help people to grow, not so much to mold them, but just to assist them in their own journey to grow.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
Yeah, I mean, you're absolutely right. When I was talking about SGM, the molding part is more at the salespeople, the younger sales force. Yeah. At that time, is to help them, to mold them to be great sales professional. Of course, over the years, when I moved into executive coaching, into leadership development, I think it's more about nurturing future leaders. It's about helping them to discover, develop. And this way, I always see myself, Jane, interestingly, as a diamond brilliant, you know, someone who I would say who is able to develop a leader just like a diamond brilliant who cut, shape, and polish the diamond, you know, or they call it the star facets, and polish them to be able to have the brilliance, the appearance of the diamond, which will affect, of course, the final cut, you know, and the value of the diamond. Just like a leader, and I see myself as a coach, is to help the leader or the high potential leader or future leader or the manager to be able to polish them to release their full potential.
I like that saying, diamond brillianteer. How beautiful.
Yeah. Yeah, so that's why I see myself. And I must admit, it's been a tough journey over the years because, you know, through my first executive coaching experience when I was with the Hay Group, working with thought leaders like Daniel Goleman, Richard Boyazis, Annie McKee, who are the experts in emotional and social intelligence. Because at that time in the 90s, the mid-90s, when I was with Hay Group, it gave me the opportunity to work with global leading organizations like IBM, Pfizer, organizations like Boeing and so forth. So that really propelled me into the area of really helping leaders to grow and learn from, you know, best practices and how organizations in Singapore and across the region can learn and help their leaders to be better. Mm. And my role to support them, and it's been both challenging and rewarding at the same time.
Yeah, I think your background and, you know, incredible education that you have as well has really positioned you very strongly to be a highly effective executive coach, leadership coach, and trainer. Well, not so much a trainer anymore, but really leadership and executive coaching. But you've gone through quite a number of transitions as well, and so I think that must have really given you the in-depth experience to understand the challenges that leaders do have, regardless of, you know, what their background may have been, whether it was in finance or marketing or sales or operations, and they get to that C level. Everyone experiences challenges when it comes to leading a team.
Yes, absolutely, you're right. So whichever role that you play, I mean, as you move from role to role, and this is something I discovered when I was in sales and marketing, moving into training, and from training moving into leadership development and HR, and then into coaching. And each time I transition to different role, and there are different set of challenges that I face in different role, obviously, because in terms of skills development, the organizational challenge, the culture, the dealing with different personality, of course, you need to manage the politics of all. So, but at the end of the day, it's all about helping your organization to be effective, or your team to be effective, by ensuring that you have the skills to be equip the skills. You need to be able to equip the skills to be able to lead the organization successfully. Now, that means it's all about self-development. It's all started with yourself. So you need to ask yourself, as you move to different roles, what does it take to succeed in that role? You know, we all talk about the first 90 days. It's all about self-awareness, about you need to know about the different stakeholders, who you need to be able to work with, whether your direct report, your boss, obviously, the most important is your boss. If you cannot manage your boss, and this is what I told all my coaches, the most important thing about in organizational development is to be able to ensure that you understand and manage your boss effectively.
So communication's the key, isn't it?
Exactly, yeah. Exactly. And then, of course, besides your boss, your other stakeholders, including your peers, your direct report, and so forth. So you need to have a very good grounding. As you move from one role, as I move from one role to another, I always ask three questions. Do I understand my boss very clearly? What are his expectations? Do I understand his style of communication? And how do I, what way do I need to flex or adapt to suit my boss way of working? That's very important. Second, and sometimes you have more than one boss. If you're in a matrix organization, you work with different bosses, so you need to make sure you identify all of them, whether direct or indirect, whether it's dotted line or whatever. Second, again, the other stakeholders, your peers, that you need to negotiate for resources, that you need to influence with the authority. These are the people you need to work with, and you don't have direct responsibility over them. And of course, your team, a little bit easier, because you manage them, they are reporting to you, you can influence greatly. So these are the different group, and they start with you. You need to ask yourself, do I have it, what it takes to do what is expected out of me? If no, what do I need to do differently? What do I need to learn, develop the learning mindset, the learning agility, and then be humble, you know, to be able to ensure that you ask for help. And a lot of time, I do not have the answers. I learn, I ask for help, be humble, and this is how you grow professionally.
Yeah, I think, I mean, you've coached many people, I know, you know, different leaders from CEOs, senior vice presidents, high potential managers. But then what advice might you give to someone who is on the track to COO or CEO or CFO and they're on the way up? If they've got multiple managers with multiple communication styles and different expectations, how do you coach them to handle all the different personalities?
Well, I think first and foremost, I think what is really important is to be able to, as I said, understand when you look at the most of the leaders that I have coached, one of the biggest challenges is that lack of self-awareness. What do I mean by that? You know, they are not able to really understand the impact they have, their style, their leadership style, their behavior onto the team, into the organization. So they need to be able to learn and understand or have that self-awareness, number one. Well, basically to address the blind spot, you know. And many, many times, I don't blame them, they're unaware. They're unaware that as you move up the leadership hierarchy, you know, or if I use Ram Charan leadership passage, you know, as you move up the leadership pipeline, you know, the next level, there are significant difference in terms of skills, values, that you need to be able to demonstrate to be successful. Now, this is very challenging for many CEOs and potential, high potential COO or any of the C-suite leader moving to the CEO role, they find it difficult to develop that transition. Now, the reason because they have been used to doing the same thing again and again, and most of them find it, look, why do I need to change? You know, and they tend to rely on the belief that they will continue to be successful if they do what they have done in the past. And as Marshall Goldsmith says, you know, what gets you here may not get you there. So mm-hmm. that's the biggest trap. And there's a Chinese saying, I remember one of my friends was reminding me, he said, to a person who has a hammer, everything else looks like a nail, you know.
Yes.
So this is important for leaders to remember. Leaders who have become successful, I look at some of the leaders I've coached over the years, they have been successful because they have developed this ability to question, to challenge their mindset, and to continuously challenge themselves by thinking, how do I adapt? How do I change my style or my situation to the new environment? Then if you fail to do that, then that would be detrimental. It's a potential derailer. Yeah,
that's very true. You know, I mean, especially these days in every organization is going through so much change constantly. I mean, the only constant really is change. And so I like that you challenge them to challenge themselves and then help them to find the way to adapt so that they can find the right solution. I know that certainly, you know, as a coach myself and when you're coaching people, sometimes they think you're a consultant. It's like, okay, tell me what to do. But that's not the job of a coach, is it?
Exactly,
what do you do? Like, one of the most challenging things I know as a coach is the coachee or the person that we're coaching wants us to solve their problems. How do you get around that?
Yeah, that is exactly one of the challenges. I mean, a coachee who consistently expect you to solve the problem. So this is what I do in the beginning. The first meeting that when I have a chemistry, we call it a chemistry session, where we have the opportunity to sit with the coachee to understand their challenge. And for us, is to assess the coachability of the coachee. And from the HR and the coachee person, the coachee is the person that you're coaching. Mm. And from the coachee perspective, is about to assess whether he or she wants to work with you. Do you have chemistry? Hence the name, the chemistry session comes about. Mm. So, but for me, is to assess the coachability. And this is where sometimes, one of the things that the belief, the mindset, the mental model of this coach is that, hey, the coach role is to provide all the solutions, all the answers, which is what the consultant does. So I from the onset, I help them to understand, what does a coach do? What's my role? What's their role? What's their boss role as a sponsor? So that is very important. So what I do is to create the understanding of the set expectations, so to speak. What are the different roles each one of us play in the coaching engagement? So this is very important. So it's not about providing the solution, about creating the opportunity for the coachee himself or herself to develop a level of self-awareness within themselves to be able to solve the problem, so that they don't rely on me as a coach to continuously solve their problem, but they are more independent, self-sufficient. Anyway, there's a saying, of course, you know, if you teach a man how to fish, you feed him for a day. If you teach him how to fish, you'll feed him for a lifetime. Mm. So this is about empowering and helping the individual to discover themselves, how to do it by themselves.
Yeah, and you know what? One of the most exciting moments or most rewarding moments for me is when you see that sudden aha moment and you see this little flash of like inspiration in their eyes when it's like, of course, I knew how to do this all along. But then it's the coaching that's drawn it out. Now, I can sense your passion and commitment to this coaching, Sattar, and I know personally that you're an excellent executive coach. What would you say is the most rewarding aspect of your role?
Well, I think the most rewarding when they come back to me, the coachee come back to me, or the CEO, if the coachee report to the CEO, they will personally feedback to me, look, hey, I've seen a dramatic improvement. I've seen the impact that leader that you're coaching or the coachee has on the business results or on their performance. So that's number one. This is the acknowledgement. Of course, there are many factors. Coaching only one part of it. There are many other factors will influence results. But the recognition that the support the coaching has provided to the individual, the effort that he or she makes to implement the action plan. So that is number one. I feel, most satisfying. And I see how they grow. Now, for most of the coaching over the, I would say over the 20 years, perhaps the last 10 years has been most rewarding in the sense that I work with mostly high potentials and C-suite who have been identified to take on leadership role. In other words, how do I groom these people? So most of them have been successful assuming a leadership, CEO or COO, or even move on to be chairman of the board of organization. And what I found satisfying when they come back to me is, look, it really makes a difference. I've learned so much. I've used those skills that you have helped me. And it doesn't only help me professionally, especially in the area of emotional and social intelligence. It also helped me personally at my home, my family, dealing with my spouse, my children, my parents, my siblings. That is most satisfying when it tells you that they are better person, they're better individuals. Not only better leader, but it makes them better parent, better father, better mother. Mm-hmm. So brother, son. Daughters and so forth. So that give me great satisfaction, and you see them transform and bloom, grow, and irrespective whatever age. And some of my coaches are in the 60s, and some in the 70s, who over the years they've never been given the opportunity, and then they welcome this opportunity to develop and still see, the need to enhance their emotional and social intelligence skills to develop their rapport, relationship with their, not only at work, but of course socially and at the family.
Coaching benefits in so many ways, and Sattar, your passion comes through so, so strongly. Now, tell me, as the Chief Executive Officer yourself of the Centre for Executive Education, tell me about the Centre for Executive Coaching and all of your plans for 2017.
Yeah, well, a Center for Executive Education is a consortium of companies across the world that we come together to provide end-to-end solution to help our client to equip their next generation leaders or next gen leaders to be able to meet the challenges in the VUCA world. So that is the purpose. We have a very specific purpose, mission to help next generation of leaders.
Now, Sattar, I need to ask you now, because not everybody who's listening will know what a VUCA world is. So VUCA, talk us through that.
Yeah, sure. VUCA stands for volatility, uncertainty, complexity, ambiguity, the state of the world today, that from the impact on business is phenomenal. If you look at the election of Donald Trump, you look at Brexit, these are black swan events which we never expect to happen. So this is a very challenging times. So I look at the currency, the fluctuation of currency, you look at the convergence of market, look at industry, confluence of industry between media, technology. If you look at how regulatory, government, statutory, regulatory, that each government, each country impose, make it very complex for you to do business. And also, if you look at consumer behavior, trend, the different generation impose, that can make it very ambiguous in terms of how you're able to develop solution products to meet the different generations. So the state of the world, the business world has changed tremendously. So we need to equip our leaders with the skills and readiness to meet head on, to be able to help the organization transform and lead them successfully through this VUCA world.
So true. And you know what? The only constant is change, isn't it, Sattar?
Exactly.
There will always be change, and as demonstrated by honestly, Brexit, who would have thought? And all the other world changes that have been happening, or world events that have been happening recently. So now, with the Centre for Executive Coaching, Centre for Executive Education, the plans for the future, what are the ones that are really making your heart sing and the most exciting for you?
Yeah. Well, thank you. I think for the Centre for Executive Education, which is the overall company that we have developed different units to help our different line of business. The Centre for Executive Coaching is primarily helping organizations to develop internal capability to train the leaders to be internal coaches. You know, that's one of the units. Of course, we have Centre for Executive Transition to help leaders to develop them to face different leadership roles or what you call role-to-role transition and so forth. But generally, the Centre for Executive Education, what we are trying to do is to help, as I mentioned earlier, how can we help organizations to prepare the leaders for the future? Yeah, and what we do is to look for coaches like yourself and, you know, experienced, seasoned practitioner who wants to go into coaching or have developed their own practice, who wants to join a network of established coaching practice. Because EDA, our Executive Development Associates in the US, is one of the leading executive coaching firms in the US, and CEE represent EDA in Asia Pacific, and therefore we continuously welcome and recruit coaches to join our panel. So our plans, to ask your question, our plans for 2017 is how can we continuously develop or strengthen the panel of coaches and talent development consultant, OD consultant, to join our panel here in Asia Pacific, and to help our client. So it's a very exciting times for us right now, and also working in this turbulent time, I always see this as an exciting time to help organizing to meet those challenges, and they need good coaches, good consultants to help them not only to help the leaders, but of course also to prepare them when the market turn around. You know, how do you then take the organization forward?
Yeah, and I mean, leaders must be prepared for any eventuality or any of the changes that may be happening too. Now, I believe Absolutely. You have a series of very interesting webinars. Tell us about that, Sattar.
Yeah, sure. I think the idea of this webinar, because of this leading in the VUCA world that I just mentioned earlier, so what we wanted to do is to help leaders to prepare for this, transition into this new business environment. How can we help the leaders to equip the skills? So we did look at research, contemporary research, based on what's happening in the U.S., especially in the U.S., because a lot of research has been done in terms of helping the leaders. So we study in our own report, EDA, publish every 2 years, trend in executive development. And one of the critical skills that's required in VUCA is called cognitive readiness. Cognitive readiness is a set of skills which combine both the mental agility or cognitive skills, those of critical thinking, strategic thinking, innovative thinking, and so forth. And how do you use that complement with your emotional and social intelligence to help you to make effective decision, or help you to in your effort to solve problems and making good decisions. So that is the essence of the program. So it's based on the CPR approach. It's contemporary. Basically, it's leveraged on the latest concept on leading in the VUCA world. Second, is practical, because it looks at examples, tools that you can immediately apply at the workplace at the end of the webinar. Third, is relevant, because it's relevant to the individual participant role as a manager, leader, and how can they help their organization to succeed. So this CPR, contemporary, practical, relevant, is embedded in the webinar series. And in this webinar, there are 6 topics. Let me just very quickly move into that. You can get it through our website, cee-global.com. But the first webinar, which we're going to conduct tomorrow, is about leading in the VUCA world. As I mentioned earlier, it's about getting them ready for the VUCA world. And in next part, we talk about result-based leadership, how to develop your emotional and social intelligence skills to be able to support the leaders, leaders to be more effective, to lead in a VUCA world. The third one in March is about managing your critical talent, how to develop and support your talent in the VUCA world, and especially the next gen, the Gen Y. How do you develop the Gen Y leaders? Most of them are now starting to assume leadership role, the middle management role. So how do you support them to be effective? So what are the sort of skills and practices in managing talent? The fourth is about coaching skills. How can you equip your leader with the coaching skills to help them to lead their team more effectively? As one of the leadership style of that's effective by Daniel Goleman is what we call leadership style of manager leadership style of coaching to be more effective. And then number five is in May, we talk about inspiring your multi-generational workforce is Gen Y and Gen Z. Again, is the next generation. How can you help and understand, help your leaders to understand the differences? And what are the expectations of these two new groups, Gen Y and Gen Z, that expects from the leaders? And lastly, in June, we talk about developing high-performing teams to compete in the VUCA world. What are some of the competency skills that in the team that you need to develop high-performing team using what we call the SCORE model that we have developed to succeed in the VUCA world? So sorry, it takes a bit long. So these are the six webinars. As I said, the details can be found in our website.
And Sattar, what I'll do is I'll have the links in my show notes on janejacksoncoach.com, so people can hop over there and click straight through it and find out more about it, because leading in a VUCA world it's such an essential skill to be able to develop in order to be able to stay ahead of the game as well, and also to understand the upcoming generations and the way that is the best way to lead them in order to develop their full capabilities. So now, Sattar, what are your top three tips for success before we must leave you, because I'm sure it's coming up for time for dinner in Singapore now. So top three tips for success.
Well, I thank you, Jane. I think as I mentioned earlier, to recap, I think the three things that I would strongly recommend everyone, including leaders who are going for transition and for everyone generally, the ability to develop agility, learning agility, learn, unlearn, relearn, to always question and challenge yourself to develop new skills and knowledge, that is very important. I think this is something where we need to learn. Of course, the Gen Y find it easier. They are used to living on technology, and they can be able to learn any time on the go. So that's number one. Be agile and continue to develop yourself. Second is, as I mentioned earlier, is about, because we are living in the VUCA world, we need to develop effective cognitive readiness skills. And what I mean by that, you need to learn about, and most of us have the ability to develop critical thinking. That's good. Strategic thinking, innovative thinking, those are great, or lateral thinking. But what is important, you need to combine that with a very high level of emotion and social intelligence, self-management, self-control, about how do you self-awareness about your own strength, your areas of development, and also how do you leverage on social relationship, relationship management. So that's very important to learn. And one book that I recommend is Working the Emotional Intelligence by Daniel Goleman. It's a very powerful book. And there are many Harvard Business Review articles on emotional intelligence by Daniel Goleman. And pick up any books on emotional social intelligence. Third, I think the other tips I will recommend is you need to continuously develop a sense of humility by asking yourself. It doesn't mean you need to know everything. There are times when even me as an executive coach, I may not have the answers, and I always tell, or as a consultant, I may not have the answers, or as a coach, and I always tell the leaders that you need to be able to be humble enough to ask for help. Even for myself, there are situations where I come to my son, I mean, who is a Gen Y, who is able to provide insights into issues regarding technology, into what is happening in the real, the social media, for example. So sometimes we need to be able to ask for help, be brave enough to ask for help, and learn and keep an open mind. And you'll be surprised what you can learn from the younger generation.
Yeah, wise words, Sattar. Very wise words. Be agile, continuously reinvent and develop yourself, develop cognitive readiness skills, and develop humility. Humility is so important. No matter how amazing one becomes as a leader, that humility is what keeps you authentic, isn't it?
Absolutely.
So what I'll do is on my website, janejacksoncoach.com, in the show notes for this podcast, I'll have all of the links to CEE Global, as well as, you know, the link to CEE Global on LinkedIn. And I think this whole series of webinars are a must attend leading in a VUCA world. So certainly all of the links via ceeglobal.com will be there. And I have to say thank you so much for your time, Sattar. I've known you for the past 16, 17 years now, and I've always been so impressed, because you as a leader and a manager have been just really inspiring to me as well. So thank you so much. And we'll have to have you come back on the show, I'd say in June, after your series of amazing webinars, and tell me how they all went.
Yeah, sure. Thank you. Thank you very much for having me here, Jane. Thank you for this opportunity. Mm-hmm. And I hope to be, and I'm open to be, you know, engaged, and any of your audience want to find out more, you know, information that I can share. This is very important sharing. And I must congratulate you, and I've been through some of your podcast interview. I think it's a commendable effort for you to be able to get impressive speakers, impressive guests on your podcast interview series, and the effort that you're doing to share and for us to learn from one another, that's commendable. I really appreciate this opportunity. Thank you very much.
Oh, you're welcome, Sattar. And let me tell you, the biggest benefit is I'm having a lot of fun. It is so good to talk to people like you, and that's what makes the world go round.
Yeah,
so,
it is very important.
Thank you. Well, we'll talk to you again soon. Bye, Sattar. Today's podcast is brought to you by Audible.com. You can get a free audiobook download and free 30-day trial at audibletrial.com/Jane Jackson Careers. There are over 180,000 book titles to choose, so give it a go and get your free audiobook today from audibletrial.com/Jane Jackson Careers.
You've been listening to Jane Jackson Careers. Sign up to receive regular career advice at janejacksoncoach.com.